The roots of jungle stem from the hardcore scene in the UK. So it was like kind of classic rave and the hardcore sound, which gradually started bringing in the breakbeats. And then I would say there was a lot of, I want to say dub influence in jungle, really, and black influence, because it was those very deep kind of dubby, dubbed out bass lines, lots of kind of reggae vocals, rare groove vocals started coming in. And so, yeah, I would say it definitely came from the hardcore scene, and it was very heavily influenced by black culture in the UK.
Jungle was created was with UK producers using more urban sounds to influence the music, like urban bass lines, hip-hop sort of samples, reggae samples and stuff. And that became the basis for jungle. So, you know, because before that you had hardcore, which was very kind of just industrial, hard and stuff. And, you know, a lot would argue that jungle was more like, you know, the urban, the black side, putting their spin on the music at that time. You get what I'm saying? Because it was still very hardcore-ish, but you had like lots of hardcore tunes with just like those reggae sort of influences in it.
The roots of jungle is hip hop and reggae. And I guess I would say that King Tubby from 1967 was the first man to create like a dub. And from that dub, like other people created like their different sections of what reggae or rubber dub or, you know, steppers, you know, these all these different kind of things, elements created these styles in within reggae music, and all that was brought into jungle. I would say, like, for me, Scientist was, like, one of the kind of people that made it easy to create, like, a steppery type sound by using, like, the echo chambers to create, like, this skippy kind of beat, which, once that's in your head, that syncopation, then when we started to speed up, like, the old hip-hop breakbeats, you could hear what was there. It was like you could hear the half time with the double time, and like, you know, it totally sat, you know, you could hear it already from like some of the really early jungle stuff.
The best thing about jungle, I guess, is the kind of all the different genres that it's kind of borrowed from: rare groove, bass lines, and generally dub wise, the breaks that you're getting from old funk records, you know, samples that even from like Detroit techno and stuff, they take whole loops and a sample from that. That's what I love about jungle. It's you can kind of add so many different flavours into it. But the roots of it is black music, and it's, I guess, dub, funk, soul, rare groove. That's where it's all kind of influenced from, and that kind of sound system culture.
I think jungle, primarily, you will hear like breaks, chopped up. Yeah, you got your sub basses and your breaks. And it's coming more from a dub kind of based background, where drum and bass is more kind, I would say, more, might have more drum machine orientated, or it's a bit more harder edge, a bit more kind of like techno influences behind it.
Jungle preceded drum and bass. So I think like late 92, 93, up until 95, 96, I think it was mostly just called jungle, and then it evolved into drum and bass. The tempos went up and the rhythms became more and more stripped down and simple, because like in jungle is, I wouldn't say all jungle, but for I think most jungle is between like safe to say it's between like 150 and 170 BPM. A lot of it, especially new stuff, is produced at like 160 BPM. And it's usually got multiple layers of breakbeats on top of each other. And it's all about like the sampled breakbeats. And in drum and bass, for the most part, those sampled breakbeats disappeared. The tempo went up to like 170, 175. And the rhythms just became more and more simple, just like... And with jungle, the rhythms are way more complex most of the time. So I think that's the main difference.
The difference between jungle and drum and bass is more the syncopation and like also for me, like the content. Drum and bass is more of a techie type music. It's usually based around the snare. There's like this one snare that basically, I think it makes it easier for mixing, and it creates like a almost like a tent pole in the track. I could say that, which then you can like tie like loads of different kind of techie things onto it, and you know, like you can create atmospheres around it, and you know. It's more of an atmospheric thing, you know, like melody isn't so much of like in the forefront with drum and bass, especially modern drum and bass. Jungle is more songy, it was based like on like old reggae and old kind of hip hop. You know, it's like a gel of these two things, the principal jungle anyway.
I guess jungle is a lot, for me, to simplify it generally, it's more breaks orientated, perhaps more heavily sample based than drum and bass. But you know, like it all kind of merges, and I think, yeah, there's other things to think about than the difference between jungle and drum and bass, because people will just argue about it forever. Do you know what I mean? And then it will get so pernickety, and it's like, oh, but this is they use a sampler and they don't. It's a drum machine and synths, therefore it makes it drum and bass. And, you know, loads of stuff that is, like jungle now, is all made just with a computer and no sampler, and you can still get the sound that sounds like heavily like old school jungle. So, yeah, I guess.
For me, the difference is... I suppose a time period, but also stylistically, they're a bit different. So I would say jungle kind of started in around 93, late 93, up until 95, late 95. So it was quite a short period of time. And before it morphed into drum and bass, which is a much more stripped back version of jungle. Jungle's very heavy on breakbeats, whereas drum and bass kind of stripped out the breakbeats and just focused on the kind of minimalistic kind of kicks and snares and hats and percussions.
Especially around like 95, 96, there were a lot of records that are right on the cusp between jungle and drum and bass, where... still to this day, it's kind of hard to define whether you'd call that like proper jungle or actual drum and bass. But I think most anything, especially around the time when, definitely around the time when drum and bass split up into different genres of its own, like neurofunk and liquid and all kinds of other techie, whatever subgenres you want to call it, those are... like there's no jungle to those tunes at all. So it's very easy to define a lot of music as drum and bass, and it's very easy to define a lot of music as jungle. There was for a couple of years, like a lot of records being released that are right on the cusp between the two. But I think for the most part, they're quite easily identifiable. So, especially the lack of sampled breakbeats in drum and bass, and the rhythms being so simple and straightforward.
If you want to explain it and you say jungle, I mean, for me, it makes sense because the term jungle and the Africa or in any jungle or whatever, it sums up that dark, moody, mysterious kind of vibe about it. You get what I'm saying? And this is what the music kind of like started to sound like. So, you know what I mean? And then where you say drum and bass now, I think that kind of came in where a lot of people wanted to move the music in a different direction because, you know, unfortunately, at its peak, jungle started to attract a lot of trouble and a lot of people wanted the music to go into a different direction. And so my take on it was like, you know, a lot of people kind of just sort of stopped working with those samples or whatever, those bass, whatever. I think, I wouldn't say stop working with them, but just kind of more, not so full on anymore. You get what I'm saying? It wasn't so full on, more minimal and geared more towards different sort of sounds to introduce into the music. You get what I'm saying? So the beat was the same. You still had the bass and the drums, but they would introduce more like jazz and rocky sounds and different sounds and just take it a bit away from that sort of urban vibe that was going on. And so I think, and I think as well, there's a thing behind it where a lot of people probably wasn't comfortable because the word jungle really similar, it felt very black. And maybe a lot of people weren't comfortable or, you know, wanted to kind of be involved in it, but didn't want that tag or something like that. So I just think somehow the drum and bass tag came about and everybody was cool with it because for me, it was just like a progression of the music. You get what I'm saying?
A lot of the people that were recording came from an era of, even if they were recording on computers and stuff, they came from an era of tape. And so there wasn't so much cut and paste. Whereas now it seems that there's a lot of cut and paste and a lot, obviously, computing power is a lot more advanced now. You can do a lot more with stuff. So there's a lot of tricks and twists and stuff like that that you didn't really get back then.
Well, obviously, like everything's... Not everything, because there's a lot of people that are like hardcore into hardware and using the same hardware that was used back in the day. But a lot of it nowadays is produced on software that didn't exist back then. So I know maybe it's gotten, for the most part, it's probably gotten a bit cleaner, maybe the productions. There's probably different influences in some of the jungle, like Duke and Footwork, which weren't around back in those days, which are being mixed into the music now. But when you, as far as like pure jungle goes, I don't know. It's a hard one to answer for me. I think there would be more one to answer for people that actually grew up on jungle back in like 93.
Back in the day, you know, you had all these choppy breaks and some of those tunes were really hard to mix and stuff. You get what I'm saying? You know, the breaks were all over the place and stuff. You get what I'm saying? But they had more vibes about them. You get what I'm saying? You know, those tunes for me, they were made more like about, you know, it didn't matter about the break so much or whatever because the vibe of the tune, what was more important at that time, whereas now I think people put more into production.
The vibe of that old school, authentic, like jungle sound is still there and it's definitely been captured by a generation that was too young to have been involved the first time around. But yeah, artists these days, I would say, because it's also a very sample heavy music. So in terms of the range of samples that are now available for producers to use and manipulate in their tracks, it's I would say it's a lot down to the individual artists. There's just new artists that have their individual take on jungle. So it's always going to be kept fresh because, you know, artists are all influenced by different things. And because of the internet and the accessibility to samples and YouTube and, you know, being able to download a break or a sample and chop it up, it everything's so accessible now. So yeah, I would say the vibe is still authentically jungle, but the producers and the artists are their individual take on jungle is what's keeping it different and new.
Well, to be honest, I mean, I started from back in the day. And if anything, you know, there are a lot of jungle and artists that I still feel and listen to and make is still very in the old school way and flavor. You know, I still use my breaks. I still chop my breaks. It's almost like the only thing that's probably changed a little is maybe some of the tempos. But at the end of the day, people are still going back to that slower tempo of jungle and still using the same techniques. But obviously, that old school sound is still revered a lot and still loved by many and many new artists. You know, you could say like your Tim Reapers, your Coco Bryces. Everyone's still, you know, FFF. There's so many, you know, I could mention. And everyone's still going back to the old school way and flavour.
I think back then they'd be so limited in terms of like sampling time and stuff like that. So they really pushed the equipment to the absolute max. Whereas now you have everything at your fingertips, which of course is good and bad. You know, it's like it can be hard to like own it down and really get to know a plugin or a sampler. Whereas back then it was like much more limited and I think much more creative as a result of that. But in terms of sound, I guess, I don't know. I think that the reason why it was this kind of like golden age is everything was so new and fresh and there was so much competition back then. And just the energy and the atmosphere that has got into those music, we're living in a different time and you're just never going to be able to recreate that. And I don't think we really should be trying to recreate it. I think we can, you know, use it as inspiration and just, you know, try and move it forward as well. I think there's still lots to explore with jungle. You know, you can kind of, and I think it's really having a moment at the moment, which I love. You know, I love to see loads of new, younger people making jungle, learning about the history of it and being total fanatics and geeks like I am.
Back in the days, jungle was more, I don't know, more songy, more melody, more experimental, you know, and I think today it's kind of lost that innocence because there's so much baggage that we have to kind of have, you know, there's all the stuff from before, obviously, and whereas there was smaller circles before. You know, there was like a few DJs, a few pirate radio stations that were involved and like, you know, people were into like just swapping stuff for dub plates or whatever. And like maybe you like 500 would get cut and that was it. You know what I mean? Whereas now it's like you put it out there, it's out there for the world and you've got to basically show something or come with something. And it's, you know, there's not, you know, back then, there was probably not so much finance involved as now. So, and that creates like another level of heaviness on top of them. So I think there's a bit of a burden that people bear the longer it goes on.
Back in the day, you would see more kind of black people and more black women and stuff in the dances, you know what I mean? Now it's like, it's, yeah, you know, we're trying and we're trying to get people back into it, but I think a lot of them left to go to, you know, Garage, and when UK Garage came out, a lot of people left for that scene because, you know, the music started changing and a lot of the old jungle is kind of moved out of it, you know. So, but, you know, it's a healthy scene, you know, we do our night Rupture and there's, you know, there's other nights out there bringing it back, and there's, you know, there's so much drum and bass about. Yeah, the scene's very healthy.
You don't have the massive raves that you did back then, the kind of like, God knows how many thousand, like 5,000 capacity raves. Like every now and then you do, but back then there were like huge raves. It's not, I mean, at the moment there's no raves, but it's much more kind of like club culture now, I guess, in London. You know, the clubs are, you know, between like 500 and 1,000 capacity. So that's quite different, that whole kind of like rave experience of there being like fun fairs at raves. I remember that. Oh, make me feel so sick. I don't know why you'd want to go on a roller coaster in the middle of a rave. But yeah, so I think in terms of the raves, there is a difference, but there's so much. There was so much. It's difficult to talk about, I guess, nightlife at the moment when everything has kind of been on hold. But it's booming. There's loads of jungle nights happening in London.
The 90s, we thought, wow, this thing was big because, you know, we had parties and stuff, big parties, Sunrise and all these big parties and Energy and everything and big field parties. And we thought, wow, this thing is massive. But let me tell you now, man, sometimes that it was just massive here in the UK and a few places around the world. Now, it's massive everywhere in the world. You get what I'm saying? You know, you know, all over Russia, all over Asia, all over the States, South America, New Zealand, Australia, Europe, everywhere. It's massive now. So back then, it wasn't in all these places. You get what I'm saying, you know?
I'm not sure if it's bigger because it was like, I think in the UK in the 90s, but of course I wasn't there. So I know, but I think it was like really, really big at the time, like early, mid 90s. But nowadays it seems to have spread way more like worldwide. You have like pockets of producers in across different cities in the States, and like in LA, you got a couple people. You got some people in Denver throwing really good nights. In Toronto, there's people in Germany, in Japan, in the Netherlands, there's a few. In France, so it's like everywhere now, which probably also has to do with the internet and everything being way more accessible to everyone. You don't have to wait for all the white labels to come to the record shops, so you could actually physically buy them. And most of the times, a lot of those records wouldn't even leave the UK.